Also from Texas, Berta Ortega and her family came to the Northwest from Arizona to keep the family together.
In 1957, my sister, my oldest sister, there's six of us, married a man from Washington State. So he brought her to the state. And at that time, my mother had just died 2 years earlier. So my father decided that this was a good place to be, and the family that she married into was okay. So we decided to follow her here.
Berta was just 9 years old.
I'll relate my experience in Topnish, where I grew up as a youth. And it was very interesting because we were always aware of our culture.
American by birth, but Mexican by culture, these children occupied two worlds. Their identity, however, took shape through family and community, more than through the English-speaking majority.
Pero en ese tiempo nos inculcó nuestros padres que eran los mexicanos. Y así crecimos, así nos fuimos formando y desarrollando eso de la identidad.
Speaking Spanish was vital to that sense of identity.
Home, we only spoke Spanish. We really didn't learn how to speak English until we went to school.
Tuve buenas personas que me ayudaron bastante aquí.
My mother never spoke English to this very day. She understands it because she's been around here a while. She's 92, as I said. She understands it, but she doesn't speak it. She only speaks Spanish, or has always spoken to us. Taught us how to read and write at home. She would give us the newspapers from Mexico, and then she would force us to read articles and then tell her what we've learned.
No me molestaba lo que la comunidad afuera de la nuestra pensaba de nosotros cuando era joven, porque me sentía seguro y me sentía a gusto y me podía relajar entre una increíble comunidad de tíos y tías.
But outside the tight circles of family and community, a society and culture dominated where things were very different.
We were limited as to who we could socialize with and who we couldn't socialize with. Primarily the kids in our neighborhood we socialized with, but outside of our neighborhood, people were not very friendly. The Americans were, you know, very harsh. There were signs when I was growing up where it said, no Spanish speaking or you will not be served.
So there was a lot of discrimination. There was quiet discrimination. They weren't coming to your face. For instance, we couldn't date white boys, or the white boys couldn't date, the Mexican boys couldn't date white girls.
Far from a safe haven, school was all too often a place where these young students experienced rejection or judgment.
When I was in the sixth grade, I had my, you know, I could have three little brothers that I was responsible for, taking them to school. You know, if we saw each other on the playground, I would say, ¿Cómo les va, mijitos? ¿Los están tratando bien? ¿Tienen amigos? And all of this. And, you know, someone would hear and they would, you know, go to the front of the classroom after recess and they would say, she was speaking Spanish. And they wouldn't even ask me. They would just say, you know, put your hands out. And so we knew the drill. And that was okay for me, you know. You have that idea that you're not gonna let them see you cry. But what almost would make me cry was that what I was going through, my little brothers were going through too.
Many of the children struggled between two views of themselves. The stereotypes of the public world were in sharp contrast to the affection of their homes.
My mother, she'd always kiss us before we went to school. And I remember her telling me, you know, just put her hands around my face and she said, you just remember, mijita, that you are just as good as, no better than, but you're just as good as anybody else. And, you know, that was like enough to get me through the day.
Despite difficult circumstances, many families valued education, but the opportunity would not be for all. Often, the older siblings worked to ensure that the younger ones could study.
Yo desde muy joven estuve en la escuela, y los que hicieron el sacrificio para que yo estuviera en la escuela fueron mis padres y los mayores de la familia, mis hermanos mayores.
Nonetheless, it was difficult for some families to imagine that their children could aspire to a university education, especially when it was the very school system that did not hold high expectations for their children. Anita remembers her high school counselor's response when she expressed an interest in further study.
And I, to this day, remember he patted me on my hand and he said, oh, He says, you are not, you know, you're not for your college material. He says, but you know what? Next year, next week, the beauty schools and the business schools are coming. I'm going to set you up with them.
There was never any conversation from any teachers or any counselors to say, you know, you need to take this class because you need to go to college.
We had little or no future because no one came to us and said, this is the opportunity that awaits you given your good academic record. Very little counseling, on the other hand, because the expectation was that we would not continue beyond high school.
El año 65 en Dele no comenzó.
El Teatro Campesino, a farm worker theater that educated laborers through public performances, arrived in the valley in the mid-60s. Its message of farm workers unionizing in Delano, California, brought with it a promise of new possibilities.
The farm workers theater performed, things changed so dramatically because the scenes were essentially farm workers taking control of their own lives and changing the whole relationship between farmers and farm workers. Something that went to the heart of the economy and the labor market of Eastern Washington.
As the nation experienced a time of great change, a new political consciousness took shape in the hearts of the Valley's Mexican-American youth.
These were the early years of President Kennedy, his promise of a new vision, of a new frontier for the country. He was a youthful man. He spoke the language of youth, and in many ways very similar to Barack Obama. So it was an empowering time.